How many were here this morning and heard Pastor's sermon on faith? I taught for 2 days in Italy, and I think he might have stole every word of my sermon. I'm not sure. Actually, you know, I love that illustration of faith being the currency of heaven. I heard that directly from God when I was preparing my teaching on faith. Faith is the currency of heaven. And you fleshed it out perfectly, brother. I just love how God speaks to you. It's amazing. Well, thank you all for being here. I didn't bring any prayer cloths. I often do that when I'm ministering overseas. I bring suitcases full sometimes. But what I do have is I have some business cards. And these have all been prayed over. I see God ministering to people through simple things like this. It's not just a focus for your faith, but people who don't even know that they're being touched by the power of God can be blessed by something like this. So I'm just going to throw these over here. Anybody, just help yourself. Take as many as you want. God bless you all tonight. I had a few things that I wanted to share before we minister. And just curious, how many people here need healing of some kind in their body? All right. Hallelujah. Tonight is your night. How many people have been in our training that was Friday night and Saturday? Okay. If you raised your hand, leave your hand up, please. If you raised your hand that you need healing, look around you. These folks that have their hands up right now, they're going to get you healed tonight. They've been trained. They've received some extensive training. And they're equipped. I've seen people activated in as little as 30 minutes and minister miracles that would blow any person away. They're just amazing miracles. God is in the business of healing people. If you have looked in Scripture for a model for how to receive healing, let me just say a couple of things about that. I love the story of the woman with the issue of blood. How she believed in her heart that if she could just lay hold of the hem of Jesus' garment, that she would be healed. Please don't use that as a model for healing. All right? How about the leper who said, "Jesus, if you're willing, you can heal me." What an amazing statement. And Jesus' response was in such a way, he responded so that we know, one, that healing is always God's will. He said, "I'm willing, not only now," because Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. "I'm willing today, tomorrow. I was willing last week, yesterday, today, and forever." Jesus is always willing to heal. But why aren't those two circumstances and those two people good models for healing? If you're a believer, those are not good models for healing. Your model for healing is Jesus. Jesus is your model for healing. Could sickness stick to Jesus? Could sickness not bow to Jesus? You don't need to lay hold of the hem of Jesus' garment if you're a believer, because you already have him in you. He is already in you, and that's what I want to talk about tonight. I'm sorry if those two people were your favorite ideas about how to get healing. If you don't know Jesus, I want you to realize that he is available to you. There is such a gift in the new birth. When we become born again, there's so much we receive. And I want to talk just a little bit about that tonight. Someone came to me during the teaching, and I think it was at the end of Friday night, and said, "Would you please pray for me?" And I said, "Okay, what would you like? What do you want prayer for?" And she said, well, I really want to be able to heal people. I want that gift to be able to heal. And I looked at her. I was actually kind of disappointed. I thought maybe, you know, I was going to really get some. Anyways, I said, no, I can't. I can't pray for that. And she said, why not? I said, because there's no such thing as a gift of healing. Now, we're not just talking about semantics. So please bear with me. If you believed that there was a gift of healing, the Bible says, refers to gifts, singular, not singular, but plural, gifts of healings. So one of the things, if you had not been here during the training, one of the things that we established was that God, number one, wants to heal everybody, everywhere, all the time, anytime, is Jesus' healing time. We also established that God wants all believers to heal the sick, that he's commanded not only his disciples, not only others, the 70 that we see in the Gospels that went out in Luke chapter 10, not only those, but that God wants to heal, God wants all believers to heal the sick. In fact, he told the 70, go out and wherever you go, whatever city you go into, heal all the sick that are there, every single one. Well, how do you do that? One by one, that's how you do it. That's why we need an army of healers. That's why we need to train men and women, children, just like y'all out there. So we learned that God has commanded believers to heal. How? Just like Jesus. How complicated did Jesus make it? He spoke the word. He laid hands. He commanded. He intended. He directed. The only thing what we don't see Jesus doing is we don't see him doing remote dead raising. But, you know, he said that we'll do greater works than he. And so maybe we'll see that one day. I'd love to be part of a remote dead raising. Just command that dead body over there in Nigeria, get up now. And in fact, I've had this vision of not just one at a time, but multiple mass dead raisings. You know, you see the news these days, and you see how there's death and destruction all over the world. I want to see believers stand together and command mass dead raisings and see people get up from a bed of death or a bed of destruction in Jesus' mighty name. We'll see it. We've been talking all weekend about healing, and our union with God is why healing happens. I was born into a family, a missionary family. In fact, on my mom's side, all my aunts and uncles are missionaries somewhere in the world. This is part of why ministry to the nations is really in my blood. I speak smatterings of a half a dozen different languages, and I've lived all kinds of different places around the world. But my parents were missionaries in the Congo, and I joined them there or lived there with them as an adolescent. And I watched missions from the inside out, and I watched how desperate people were in different places for the gospel. I decided as I was growing up that I really wanted to help people. I wanted to be a doctor when I was growing up, but I had a high school counselor that told me I was too stupid, so I ended up being an airline pilot. Actually, he was saying my grades weren't good enough, but so I ended up being an airline pilot. I went to Bible school and learned how to fly, and I went back to Africa as a missionary pilot. Went to the Congo as a missionary pilot. And it's kind of amazing to me looking back, but I went to the Congo, even though I'd grown up there and seen everything that happened there and what the people were like, what the culture was like. I went totally unprepared for the spiritual warfare that I faced. And within 2 years, I was neutralized. Isn't that amazing? I mean, it's just, it blows me away to think about it. Within 2 years, I was neutralized. So that by the end of 2 years, My father had been on a taken an extended leave of absence. He came back. I was already a backslidden missionary by that time. A few short months after my father returned, he was involved in a plane crash. He was involved in an accident, engine failure in a narrow valley, nowhere to turn except for a place that was full of people. And my father turned away from the people that were working in their gardens and was killed. Well, I developed this massive offense against God. I became so angry. I left the mission field. I left the church altogether. I became so offended. I developed such an offense against God that if I could have denied his existence, I wanted to. I wanted to be able to say, God, there's no such thing as God. God doesn't exist, but you know, I was an airline pilot, and I'd be flying in the middle of the night in some South African or South American sky. I'd see stars, just like diamonds, spread across the sky. And I'd look at that. I'd see shooting stars. I'd see the moon. I'd see the sky. And I'd look at it, and I'd get angry. It would make me angry because I wanted to deny that God existed. But I'd look at creation, and I couldn't. I couldn't deny that he existed. I'd see the dawn of the morning and the colors and just the shooting rays of the sun as it was peeking above the horizon. I wanted to deny that God existed, but I couldn't. I couldn't deny God's existence. It's amazing. You know, when I lost my father, I lost my way. When I lost my father, I lost my identity. When I lost my heavenly father, I lost my way. You know, it's our fathers who give us identity. Our fathers give us our identity. And that's what I want to talk to you about briefly tonight. Our fathers define us. Understanding your union with God changes how you view your identity. And knowing your identity is key to how you live. This is not just about healing. It's about everything. The lessons that you learn in healing ministry apply to everything. If you were here earlier in the weekend, you heard me say this. There's two great challenges that everybody faces in their faith. The challenges of healing. Will God heal me? Does God want to heal me? Does God want to touch my loved one? That's the first challenge, healing. The second challenge to our faith is finances. Everyone. You know, there's actually another challenge that most people face, and it's more and more prevalent in North America. Not as much as elsewhere in the world, but that promise of God for protection. If you live in Pakistan and you give your life to Jesus, if you come from a Muslim family, you are in serious condition with your families rejecting you, possibly putting a fatwa on you or some kind of a death sentence on you just because you have given your life to Jesus. Understanding our union with God changes how we view our identity. And it changes, it's key to understanding how to live. In Genesis 1:26, God said, let us make man in our own image. But it's not just about looking like God, it's about being like God. I'm talking about union with God. And this is very key to healing ministry, but it's also key to living in victory in every area of your life. It's finances, it's protection, it's ministry. The secret of Christianity is not in the act of becoming a Christian. That's good. It's good to become. It's good to be born again. And I'm going to talk about very briefly about why the new birth is one of the greatest gifts of God to mankind. The secret in becoming a Christian is being, the action of being one. Is a tree tried? Or is a tree concerned? Is he tried to, is he worried about how to be a tree? Is a tree worried about how to look like a tree or how to become a tree? No. Tree just hangs out there, grows, sticks his hands up in the air, branches, waves. I love Psalm 92:12. It says, the righteous shall be like a palm tree. The righteous shall be like a palm tree. What's so significant about a palm tree? We live in Florida, right? We have a lot of palm trees here. What's significant about a palm tree in the midst of a windstorm or a hurricane or some kind of storm like that? Palm tree, what do? They bend. If you're an oak or some other kind of hardwood tree, what happens? If the wind comes, the storm comes, you're cut off. You're broken off. We saw a lot of that during Hurricane Ivan, didn't we, and some of the other hurricanes here. But if you're a palm tree, you bend in the storm, and then when the storm is past, you come upright. The righteous are like a palm tree. It's because of who you have in you that makes you like that. Our identities come from our Father. So the question that we have to ask spiritually is, who is our Father? 2 Corinthians 7:18, I will be like a father to you, and you should be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Wow. John 14, Jesus is speaking to his disciples. He said, if you had known me, you would have known the Father. Jesus, everything that Jesus is, represents something that the Father, that is also in the Father. Not everything of the Father is in Jesus. In other words, we don't see everything revealed that God is infinite. There's no way that infinity can be manifest in one man. But everything that you see manifested in Jesus is also manifested in the Father. They're the same. He said, I and the Father are one. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He said, I am in the Father and the Father is in me. How is that possible? I am in the Father and the Father is in me. In that day, he says, you will know that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, and I in you. What's Jesus saying? He's saying this. When you get this, that because I live, you also live. When you know that, then you'll know that I'm in the Father, and the Father is in me, and I in you. You will know that we are all in union. In 1 John 4:15-17, it says, he who confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, then the Father abides in him, and he abides in the Father. Again, it's the same thing. I'm in you, you're in me. How is that possible? This is union with God, and it's in love that this is perfected. What does that look like? Well, I asked this question one time, if there's any cooks, and I'm sure there's a few cooks here. I mean, this is a good southern town, but probably you don't know, maybe you know how to make pizza from scratch. With pizza, I don't know, actually, maybe there's, something with flour and egg. I don't even know if there is egg in pizza, because you can tell I'm not a cook. But let's say you have a bowl of flour and you crack a couple eggs in it. Now, cooks, listen to me. If you're a cook, listen closely. What happens when you mix the egg and the flour? What happens when you mix the egg and the flour? They become one. They're mixed together. Once you've mixed the egg and the flour, can you separate them? No, you can't separate the egg and the flour. Once you've mixed the egg and the flour, can you pick out the egg from the flour in the bowl? Can you see which part is the egg and which part is the flour? You can't. They're so mixed up together that they're in union. Here's another example. When I become born again, what happens is Jesus puts me on like a football jersey. Can you imagine that? Just imagine your favorite football team. If it's, Red Tide or whatever. We have some Alabama fans here in the front row. So anyways, whatever their team is, I don't know those names. I grew up in Africa, so I don't really follow sports, but Jesus puts me on like a football jersey. He just slips me on, and this is what happens after that. I take this jersey everywhere I go. Everywhere I go. Everywhere I go, Jesus is in me. I'm just a piece of cloth. I'm just a limp piece of cloth. Without Jesus, I'm nothing. But because of the new birth, everywhere I go, I have Jesus in me. Listen, this is why healing happens. Right? So when I bring Jesus to the scene of some need, when you bring Jesus to the place of some dire need, you're bringing him to the scene of the miracle. He's there. We don't have to beg him to come down. We don't have to beg, we don't have to work Jesus up in us because he's already in us. We're just a football jersey. Do you see the union that that represents? There's another example. I'm an airline captain. I wear a uniform. When I am walking in uniform, I automatically get a certain kind of respect. People don't know me. They don't know my name. They don't know where I've come from. I mean, they know nothing about me, and yet they see the uniform. They see the stripes on my shirt or maybe on my jacket. They, if I was wearing a hat, they would see stripes or some kind of insignia on my hat. And immediately, Captain, if you're the pilot in command, you have absolute authority. You really do have life and death authority. People recognize that, and they see it. They acknowledge it. But when I get out of my uniform, I'm really nobody. When I get out of my uniform, I don't get that same kind of respect. If I walked, unless they knew me personally, if I walked into my airplane without my uniform, without my identification, some security person is immediately going to go, stop, who are you? Who do you think you are? Well, wait, it's my airplane. I just got off of this airplane. No. You don't have any identification. You're not in uniform. Get out. Right? That's what union with God is. When you are in uniform, you're in union with God. Am I making myself clear here? This is so important. This is the kind of understanding that gave John Lake and his 16 helpers the strength to go through 100,000 people in 5 years in Spokane, Washington. Every single one healed. Doctor verified healings. The most amazing kind of healing that you can imagine. Every kind of cancer withered, literally they said withered under their hands. No, there was no tumor, there was no disease, there was no condition that was not healed. People came every day for an hour or so to this healing room before they until they were healed. And some were healed on the first day. 50% were healed on the first day. And some went until the 30th day, but not one who came and stayed the course failed to receive healing. Every single one. Well, it was this understanding of our union with God that caused this healing to happen. It was something that people didn't understand in that day. And really, even literally now, don't understand. It's why I said the woman with the issue of blood and the leper who was begging Jesus for healing, those are not good models for healing if you're a believer. A good model for healing if you're a believer is Jesus, because no sickness stuck to him. John Lake could actually literally take bacteria, live germs in his hands, and it was examined under a microscope, and when this live bacteria touched his skin, literally the doctors, the pathologists, could watch the bacteria die. That's divine health. That's what we're supposed to walk in. That's union with God. What else does this look like? 1 Corinthians 6:17 says, we're one spirit with God. It says, he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with God. I had some stuff I was wrestling with in my body, and it wasn't going away. So I'm just struggling. Lord, you know, I realize I command and sickness is supposed to bow. This isn't happening as fast as I want it to. And the scripture that the Lord woke me up with was these words. I am one spirit with the Lord. I am one spirit with the Lord. When I heard those words, I was still waking up. I really wasn't even quite awake. I just began to weep. I'm one spirit with the Lord. I am one spirit with the Lord. The same passage of scripture says, my body was made for the Lord. And the Lord is the only thing that my body needs. Wow. When I got that revelation, it became my confession. We had such an amazing experience here in worship earlier. And what I noticed was, you all are commanding. You're commanding. Sickness cannot stay here. Sickness has to leave. That's a command. That's how Jesus healed the sick. That's how Jesus cleansed the circumstance, cleansed every situation. Sickness cannot stay. Evil cannot stay. It must go. You guys are learning how to command. You're detailing. You're telling the enemy what you want him to do. Jesus said in John 15, I'm the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for apart from me you can do nothing. I know this is Florida. Y'all probably don't have any grapevines here, but what does a grapevine look like? You know, I mean, it's a plant. It's like, you know, got like shoots out here and grapes grow at the end somewhere and there's leaves that come. What does a grapevine look? When you think about a grapevine as a farmer, you know that the vine is the whole plant. Just tell me, think about a grapevine. Tell me where the beginning of the vine is and where the beginning of the branch is. Seriously, tell me. How do you tell? You can't really tell. It's the whole plant. The whole plant. That's a description of our union with God. Here's another description. It says in Ephesians that Jesus Christ is the head of the body. That we're the body of Christ, right? But Jesus Christ is the head of the body, right? Okay. I have a head, I have a body, right? Is my head the only part? I mean, is this who I am, just my head? Is this just me, this part of me? Is that all that is me? No. My body has a head, but it's all me. It takes all of me, and that is it. That is the way it is with the body of Christ. Jesus is the head, but it's still all him. He's the body. The head is not alone. It's all the body. Is that too complex? Jesus is everything. He's the vine. He's the vine. He's the branch. It's all Jesus. Jesus flows in and out and through it all. The same with the body. The head is Jesus. We're the body. But without it all, we are all part of Christ. We are in Christ. He is in us. Christ is the head. The church, the redeemed community of believers in Christ, is the body of Christ. God's purpose was always union with man. That is why the new birth is one of the greatest gifts to mankind. Here's just a few things that happen to me when I tell Jesus I want to be born again. Jesus takes up residence in my physical body. Wow. That's union. I'm forgiven of all my sins. Jesus takes all of it. My failures and mistakes are made right. My spirit is made alive. I begin my eternal life with God. I'm adopted. I become God's son. I am God's son. Thus I can say that I am your servant. Just like Jesus served the bride. Jesus served the bride. I am your servant, but I am also the devil's master because I'm in Christ, because he's in me. Are you getting this union with God? Someone asked me, one of the questions that we got in the course of our training was, what are you thinking when you're praying? Well, I'm thinking, Jesus. Jesus is standing in front of this person. The ministry of reconciliation says we come in Christ's stead. That means in his place, just as if it was Jesus. What would Jesus do if he was standing in front of your need? What would Jesus do if he was standing in front of your sick body? Would he send you away? Would he say, I want you to learn something. Just tough it out. No, Jesus died for this. Jesus deserves to see the reward of his suffering manifest as physical healing in your body right now. Healing is always God's will, right here, right now. Things that happen when I become born again, my spirit is made alive. I'm adopted. I become God's son. My father comes to live me. He showers me with his affection. I love my grandchildren. I have 8 of them, and I just shower them with kisses every chance I get, especially the little ones. They're the ones that they don't run away as fast. The Spirit of God comes to live in me. I get his power. I become a new creation. I'm a new species of being. Jesus exchanges with me everything that I had for everything that he has. What powers did Jesus have? Did Jesus need a gift of healing to heal? No. In fact, he said, I don't do the works. It's my Father in me. He does the works. That's how it is with us. You don't do the healing. It's him. It's Jesus. It's the Father in you. He's the one who does it. Does that take the pressure off? Wow. For me, it totally takes the pressure off. Right? So I get to choose who I want to heal, when I want to heal them, how I want to heal them, whether I lay hands on them, whether I point at the situation or the sickness or the condition, whether I give them a business card that's been prayed over or a prayer cloth, or whether I give them some water that's been prayed over, anything. Whatever I choose, after that, everything is Jesus. It's all him. In my spirit, I'm seated in heavenly places with Christ. I gain the ability to act and think just like Jesus. I have the mind of Christ. What does Jesus think when he's healing? It's finished. That's what Jesus thinks. It's finished. The same thing that he said on the cross. It's finished. I gain authority over all sickness and disease. That becomes mine. Everything that's under Jesus' feet is also under my feet. If I'm seated in heavenly places with Jesus, everything that's under Jesus' feet is also under my feet. When I'm in Christ, he's in me. When I'm in Christ, everything that's under Jesus' feet is also under my feet. Everything that is under his feet. Jesus said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto me. He has it all. So what happens when I'm in Christ? When I'm in Christ, I also have it all. This makes religious people very uncomfortable. But I'm going to tell you, this is the truth. This is the word of God. I'm just reading the scripture. It's all I'm doing. The ability to properly rule over the earth is restored to me. The devil can't touch me. It's what Jesus said. He said, nothing shall by any means harm you. You believe what you get. Believe it, brothers and sisters. This is what Jesus said. He said about the devil, nothing shall by any means harm you. I become the beneficiary of all of God's precious promises. I partake in God's divine nature. I become immersed in God's great love, and I can't ever be separated from it. I get an amazing part in the family business, the kingdom of heaven. I have immediate access to the bank of heaven. I'm given a checkbook with unlimited blank checks. This is what Jesus said. Ask anything in my name, and I will give it. If I wrote you a check right now for $1 million, and you took it in your hand, this is a little like your illustration of the $10 bill. If I wrote you a check for $1 million and put it into your hand, would you have $1 million? No, you would not. What you have is a promise to pay $1 million. But you think immediately, wow, you know, if you believe that I'm capable of delivering $1 million, if I write a check for $1 million, you're thinking, yes, it belongs to me. I'm a millionaire, right? The truth is, you have to take my check to your bank. Your bank comes to my bank and collects $1 million and transmits those funds back to your account. When that happens, then you have $1 million. Look, every promise in God's book is true. We become partakers of his divine nature when we claim these promises. These promises belong to us. That's like that check for $1 million, right? Believe that you've received it and it will be yours. That's what Jesus said. It will be yours. Beloved, tonight, I'm writing you a check for $1 million. I'm giving you revelation that will save your life and save the lives of your loved ones. It'll save some stranger's life. I'm giving you revelation from the Word of God that can change your life, that can change the way that you see your problems. If you have Jesus in you, is there any problem that can stand against him? Any problem concerning employment, unemployment, or any kind of legal problem, or any kind of government issue, or any kind of problem with your employer, can any of those things stand against Jesus? Can sickness stand against Jesus? No. Having Jesus in you is the gift of healing. I don't need somebody to lay hands on me to give me the gift or to impart the gift of healing. We've been chasing anointings too much. We need to chase the anointed one. He's the one that has it all. Jesus has it all. I have the one who created this healing evangelist or that healing minister or whoever's going to lay hands on me to impart a gift of healing. I have the one who created him in me. I have the anointed one. He is my gift of healing. I instantly have access to all the supernatural abilities and powers that Jesus had when I become born again. Anything becomes possible for me. Things I could never do before, I can do now. Things that Jesus could do, I can do, and greater. That's what he said. I become like Jesus in this world, God's son, man's servant, and the devil's master. I challenge you, like your pastor, I challenge you now. I invite you into this life of faith. It's a life of power. Faith is the key to the greatest power in the universe, and that person lives in you. Faith is how you access it. Amen? So I wanted to take some time to activate those who went through our class, and I know that there are some of those folks that are waiting specifically for activation, and I was pondering exactly how to do this. I don't know how many people here were in our class, again, that are wanting activation in healing ministry. Raise your hand again. Okay. All right. So if you came to our class either day, the first day, because we had activations both days, if you were in the class, just come on up here and stand in a line across the front of the sanctuary. Just right here. Healing ministry is so simple. How did Jesus heal? Well, I'm going to give you the basics, but basically, how Jesus healed was he spoke to the condition. That's okay, just line up. He spoke to the condition, and he commanded it to go, and that's how we heal. Among other things, that's how we heal. So the way that I've taught the basics of how to do healing ministry, the way that I taught is ask the person first what problem they have, what can't they do, and then speak to that condition and command it to go. Command that condition to go, and then speak to their body and tell the body to do what you want it to do. So is there anyone here who has, we're just going to do a little review, anyone here who has pain in their body? Some, okay, ma'am, come on. And I want somebody here, one of our students, to demonstrate how healing works. So just, ma'am, just come on over here. It's right in the middle. That's good. That's good. Now face the pumpkin here. All right. So you're going to ask the question.
Do you have pain in your body? Where is it at?
Lower back and the hips, both hips.
Both hips and the lower back? Okay. Can I put my hand right here?
Sure.
Pain, in the name of Jesus, I command you to go right now. Be gone out of these hips and be gone out of this back right now in Jesus' name. Be gone.
Check it.
Check it.
It's still there.
It's still there.
From where it was before, how has it changed?
Is it less?
On a scale of 1 to 10.
Okay. Yes. All right.
So pain, I told you to go right now in the name of Jesus. I bind this pain from your body and I loose the fire of God into you right now in Jesus' name. Be gone. Check it.
Check it. Try to do something you couldn't do before. Yeah, yeah. That's it. Here, just walk a little bit. Okay. Okay. It's less? All right, praise the Lord. Okay.
I speak to the right side of this back right now in the name of Jesus. You spirit of pain, I bind you now. Be gone from this body right now. Fire. Fire of God. I call the fire of God to burn this pain from this body right now in Jesus' name. Glory to God.
Okay. Check it. It's less? Okay. All right. All right. So what I want to make a note of to illustrate here is that something has changed. Right? It's not the same as it was, right?
Right.
Something's changed. And how did that thing change? It changed because a believer commanded it to change. A believer laid hands on and commanded it to change. Something changed. Here's what you know. Here's what we know about that. If something changes, if it moves, we know we can drive it out, right? If it moved in response to a command, we know that we can drive it out. So what I want you to do is I want you to go over there with my brother, and he's going to finish that up for you, and we're going to get the folks that are waiting for healing. If you need healing, what I want you to do is I want you to come to the line here. If you're here and you need healing, just come right over here to this line. When we impart healing, we impart life. Whatever you need. If you need healing, even if it's a little pain, just line up right here. And you're going to, come on, you can just line up here, the next person, the next person, the next person. That's it. Just line up here. You don't have to worry. We don't want people to fall down, all right? So if you've received the training, I want you to hold their hands like we taught you, right? We don't want people to fall down. You don't need to fall down to get healed, all right? In fact, sometimes, let me tell you, if I'm praying for someone and they fall down, I follow them down because it could be a spirit trying to get away from the healing ministry. All right, so if you're a healer, you're basically just asking very simply, what can't you do? What pain do you have? What kind of pain do you have in your body? Hallelujah. If there's anyone out there that just any condition, anything. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. What is this process? What's the pain? Identify the limitation and then command it to leave. The very next words, check it. Check it. All right. If you have received, please fill out a testimony card. If you've received healing while you're receiving ministry here, during the course of ministry, please fill out a testimony card. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We don't beg Jesus for healing. That's really the woman with the issue of blood. She came with an attitude of begging. The man, the leper who came to Jesus saying, if you are willing, you can cleanse me. I can be made clean. He came with an attitude of begging. We don't beg Jesus for healing. He has already done everything that was required. Everything that was required. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. All right, no long prayers. No long prayers. Command and then check it. Just command and then check it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody get a testimony. Okay. All right. Here's one right here. No long prayers. Jesus, you don't see Jesus praying hours. Come in. Did you receive, my brother? Okay. Hallelujah. Go fill out a testimony card. Thank you, Jesus. One of the ushers has testimonies, testimony cards. Hallelujah. Okay. In Jesus' name. If you've received, please fill out a testimony card. You're finished. If you've already imparted healing, if you've already got your person healed, my sister over here has graciously agreed to receive from all of the trainees, any of the trainees, and I want every single one of our trainees to lay hands on my sister. What do you have to do? You just command life. In Jesus' mighty name. I preached a very similar sermon to what I preached tonight when I was in Italy. And at the end of it, it was about dominion. At the end of it, the folks were so stirred up, they laid hands on a gal in a wheelchair. And she was completely paralyzed. Totally no feeling, and she began to have feeling in her legs. In fact, so much that she said, oh, it hurts. Just command life. Just lay hands on my sister and command life. No long prayers. Just release life. You have life in your hands. Remember, you're in union with Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ lives in you. You have power, just like he had power. Just like Jesus had power, you have power. If you're here and you want anything from God, any kind of freedom, just come up to one of our prayer team, one of our team members, one of our classmates, and let them release the power of God into your body. Hallelujah. All right, how's it going here? Are we receiving? You're starting to get feeling back. Oh, thank you, Jesus. All right. She's starting to get feeling back. This is what you call the working of miracles. We have in our minds, we have set way that we think we want it to happen, or we think it's supposed to happen. Command it. Sometimes when you command, a person has a back problem, you lay your hands on their back. Just command once. Just hold your hand there and watch the power of God move. You don't have to keep commanding. It's not about us anyways. We're joining together with Jesus. It's a ministry of unity. It's a ministry of union. How are we doing? Okay, all right. Someone's just receiving. Testimonies. I want some testimonies in Jesus' name. That's good. Okay. Excellent. I have a great testimony. When I was in Pakistan, I was being interviewed by some friends at Gawahi TV, friends from Rise Up in Grace Ministries, Brother Danish Peter and his wife, who this church supports. Y'all support him. And at the end of the program, I began to declare healing over the people that were watching. And one of the people that heard that program, as I began to declare life, 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 as I began to declare that, she had her baby in her womb. She had a baby in her womb that was dead, that had been dead for some time. And so she immediately heard that. She said, "I'm claiming that for my child." And as soon as she decided that she would claim that, the baby jumped in her womb. And later, some months later, a perfect child, perfect baby was born. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, I release healing power over everyone in this room. I release healing power over those who are online, watching online, or those who will watch this later by DVD or listen by CD. I release healing power now in Jesus' mighty name. I command every infirmity, loose you now. Leave your body now in Jesus' name. Broken bones, be healed now in the name of Jesus. I command cancers to wither now. I cancel every death sentence against you now in Jesus' mighty name. I command new organs to be recreated. Heart conditions, be healed in the name of Jesus. I command shortened legs, shortened arms, become the same length. I command the body to be made whole. Every defect, leave your body now in the name of Jesus. By Jesus' wounds, you were healed. By Jesus' stripes, you were healed. I command blind eyes open now in the name of Jesus. Those needing glasses. If you want to get rid of your glasses, I command your eyes to see right now. 20/20 vision now in the name of Jesus. Deaf ears, open. Open now in the name of Jesus. Perfect hearing. Perfect hearing in Jesus' mighty name. I command mental illness be healed now, whatever the label. Paranoid schizophrenia, be healed now. Bipolar, be healed now. If the spirit of depression is on you, get off of them now in the name of Jesus. Set God's people free. Set the people free now in Jesus' mighty name. I command all childhood illness and defect down to the DNA level, be healed now in Jesus' name. Down syndrome, be healed now in the name of Jesus. You be made right in the name of Jesus. Mental retardation, be made right. Let the brain, let the body be made whole. Let these children meet each developmental target now in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I command breast tumors to dissolve now. I command breast lumps, go in Jesus' mighty name. You dissolve, you disappear. You go now and leave perfect flesh. I command every damage done by medication or by medical procedure be healed now in Jesus' mighty name. I command all disfigurement be made whole now in Jesus' mighty name. Every defect, go. We command perfect bodies restored in the name of Jesus. We recognize in heaven and we say, on earth as it is in heaven, perfection on earth in these bodies now as it is in heaven. Broken legs, bodies damaged by accident, be healed now. Broken backs, broken necks, broken arms, be healed now in the name of Jesus. We command Alzheimer's, leave the people of God. Alzheimer's, get out now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. If I haven't mentioned your condition, receive your healing now in Jesus' name. If I haven't mentioned your condition, Jesus knows it. It takes no word of knowledge for him. He has perfect understanding. Let him who raised Jesus from the dead, who lives in you, give life now to your mortal body in the mighty name of Jesus. We speak to those who are on deathbed in the name of Jesus, even in this city. Get up now. Be made whole now. We say to those who are in a coma, be made whole now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we give you praise. We give you praise. We give you honor and we give you glory. Can we have some testimonies? If you were healed during our classes over the last few days, or if you were healed here tonight, and I know there's a lot of testimonies. If you were healed and you want to give a testimony, come on, come, please. People need to get the benefit of what happened. If you went out after one of our classes and you laid hands on somebody and they were healed, come here and testify to it. Is there anybody like that? Just raise your hand. Any testimonies? Come on.
So this morning I was at church and it was just a normal Sunday morning, you know. I usually participate in the altar ministry at Brownsville. And I just felt the spirit of faith come upon me, just the gift of faith, because, you know, I've been so immersed this weekend about what the Word says and about who we are in Christ. And as He is, so are we. And this morning, I just felt that presence, that sweet presence of Jesus. And there was a lady that came in and she couldn't hear very well out of this ear. And I placed my hand over her ear and I commanded her ear to open up and she could hear in it just as good as the other one. And hallelujah, all glory to be to Jesus. A woman came in a walker and she was having severe pain in her back and her lower back, and I commanded the pain to be gone. It went down a little bit and I continued to minister to her and command the pain to leave, and it was completely gone. She was completely free of that pain. Hallelujah.
Can I get a testimony from anyone who never healed anybody before in their life, but they took this training and got somebody healed? We got some people like that here. Anybody like that? Come on. All right, another testimony. Sister. Okay, you prayed for them? Okay, go ahead.
After the I left and went home from the class last night, and I received a text from my girlfriend who lives over in Dallas, and she said for a couple of weeks she's been mostly off her feet for severe pain. So I did the commanding through the text. And
you texted a command?
Yes. It was a real gentle command. Because I like to talk gentle. But it was strong because it was Jesus. And she shouted back with me on text with lots of exclamations. And just within a minute, she said, "The pain is gone."
So wait. What kind of phone do you have? Is it like a super anointed phone?
Jesus is anointed.
So you texted on your phone to your friend in Dallas based on what you learned during the seminar, and this person was healed. The pain left.
Yes.
Wow. Thank you. Jesus is amazing. Y'all heard my stories about doing that. Now you've heard more. Somebody here in Pensacola did that. Had you ever healed anybody by text before?
No.
Okay. I bet you won't hesitate to do it again, will you? Hallelujah. One more testimony.
I feel like the Lord healed me. I had been having pain in my lower back, like a sciatica or a sharp cramps. And it had been going on for quite a while in the morning. And when I came, we were practicing, so to speak. We had learned. And I felt this relaxed feeling, and many times do I have a warm or a burning sensation, but it was a real relaxed feeling and then kind of cool. And I haven't had a bit of problem since. And this was the first night, the lady who was working with me over here, Loida. And it was a real blessing, and it was exciting because once you have that happen, you know that you have that authority and you can use it, and it can't come against you.
Wow, so hang on just a second. Somebody who was a student in the school was pretending to heal. She was practicing. Yeah, she didn't pretend, obviously, but she was practicing during our practice session, and you actually got healed.
Yes, that's true.
Hallelujah. Raise your hand. Are you the one? Hallelujah. Thank you, sister. Thank you, sister. You won't be afraid to go out and do that again, will you? Hallelujah. Saturday morning, you did it again? Hallelujah. Well, write us a testimony. Write us a testimony and tell us what happened. Did you get any results on Saturday morning? Okay. All right. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anybody else want to give testimony? We're giving God praise. We're praising Him. Brother in the back there, come on up. Hallelujah. Oh, we have several. Wow. Okay. Tell me what happened.
Well, I'm a avid witness, you know. I've been around, and God has really revealed Himself to me in some powerful ways, you know. And
you're a nut.
I'm a nut for the Lord. Amen. I fell off the tree alive. Hello. I'm a seed with a tail. Anyhow, my God is good. And, you know, that power dwells within all of us, and that power is love. And God is a spirit. And it comes from a deep sense of worship. You know, God has been showing me the more that we worship Him in spirit, the more that we get on our knees and acknowledge Him on the cross. And He says, you know, virtue. when the virtue leaves us, we build an account, like a supercharged account in Christ. You know, when we're sitting out there doing the works of God, letting the Spirit work through us, and we're denying the flesh, we're denying ourselves to keep ourselves cleansed of anything of our own strength, and we're just letting Him rise in us daily and watching Him work through us. It's amazing, because he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw him. He'll draw him. He'll start to tell you something. That man right there, he's got a sickness. Go over there and let me heal him. Yeah. Let me show you. And then a lot of times he'll speak and he'll say, he wants us to show the infirmity, the reason for it. That way that when they're healed, sometimes there has to be some works before the healing takes place, like a flushing of the system, a changing of the diet, because God don't want us to live in our sicknesses. The sicknesses have a root, and that's the sin, and we've got to find these things out.
We know the power of God is actually, there's no sin that stops the power of God for healing.
It doesn't stop it.
Yeah.
But you know, when we get healed, He don't want us to, like, if we have an infirmity of the flesh that come from an eating disorder or something like that, when He heals us, He don't want
Amen.
Us to go right back into the sickness that brought us into that.
So
death.
What's your experience? What's your testimony?
Well, I was at a friend's house one day, and God used me to minister to this homeless man. He was going to actually kill himself one night. And God took me 20 miles outside of town and brought me in town to this man I never knew. And then I became friends with him after God saved his life. And then He brought me to his daughter's house that was in a wheelchair. And God just had me speak over this woman and gave her the encouragement. She's not in the wheelchair now.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, brother. Thank you for that testimony. Another testimony.
Yeah, I got healed yesterday. A while ago, I used to serve, and I served for a couple of years, and I threw my shoulder out, and someone told me that, well, once you throw it out, it's kind of always going to be like that. And I said, I don't receive that. But for this whole year, I've been waiting for healing from it. And yesterday I was hanging out with someone after the class, and they just laid hands on me, and we prayed for about 20 minutes. And during worship, I've never been able to, like, lift my arm like much higher than this. Well, for the past year anyways. And now I have full motion without any problems. It's like right back to normal again. So, hey, praise Jesus.
Tell me, what did it feel like when that happened, when you first realized that you had full motion?
It was a really, really weird feeling, because I hadn't done it for so long, and I surprised myself. He pointed out to himself, he said, your arm's all the way up. I didn't realize it was all the way up at first. I thought it was over here, and he's like, your hand's all the way up here. I was like, I had to look at it.
What was your first thought?
Wow. Like, that really happened. So it was big, yeah.
Thank you for sharing that. Amazing. Hi. You have a testimony. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, recently I haven't done anything to my lower back to stress it out or to pull it or anything, but recently when I've been working, I have to lift ice buckets, I have to carry trays out to people, pick up plates, and it's not just one, it's like multiple plates, and so it gets pretty heavy, and just in my lower back, it started hurting really bad. It was really rough, it wasn't flexible. To where I can move it, because every now and then, like 5 minutes after doing a task, I would have to go in the back and stretch. And it was getting on my nerves. And then yesterday, when we were praying for healing, like, as the person was praying for me, I was healed. Like, I was testing it while he was praying, and I was healed. And so it's
awesome. Did it happen all of a sudden, or was it gradually?
Well, like, when he was praying, I just felt like God say, test it. And so.
So you tested it?
Yes.
And it was perfect?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's the kind of punch that Jesus delivered. Bam! One punch, and it was healed. Any more testimonies? You got a testimony? I'll be right back.
Last night, my ear was hurting really bad. And I told my husband, why don't you get up and get me an aspirin? And he just turned around and said, be gone, pain. Yeah, because he's so lazy, he felt that was even better. And he said, can I go back to sleep now? I go, yeah.
That's awesome. Hallelujah. You see, it is possible to heal without love. It is possible to heal without love. No, I think that was loving. It was just a little bit of love.
I have been blind in my left eye for about 6 years now. I had a retinal detachment. Right now I can see light and shadow on the left-hand side.
So hang on just a second. You're seeing light where you couldn't see anything before? Wow, and it was your left eye?
Yep.
Oh, great. Is there anyone here that wants to work a little bit more with my brother and get him totally, totally set free? Who of our students here who wants to do that? Tyler? All right, you want to go back there and sit with Tyler? Yeah, he's that blonde-headed kid right back there. Yeah, ketchup shirt, yeah. Get him healed, Tyler, 100%, right? No reason for you for him to leave here without perfect vision. Any other testimonies? That's an amazing testimony. Somebody with a detached retina. I'm telling you, if you can move blindness or any other kind of infirmity, you can drive it out. That's what we know. If you can move it, you can drive it out. No other testimonies. Okay, one more.
When I first went up to get prayed for, I was experiencing a lot of pain, like in my pretty much neck and shoulder and full back area. I have several herniated discs due to an accident, and the pain was pretty much bothering me, mainly over here, and literally it just dissipated.
So let me ask you something. You say that you had several herniated discs. I've never heard of herniated discs that didn't cause pain. So you must have new discs. Huh? Don't you think? Yeah, totally new. Jesus made you new. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Who was the person that prayed for you? Who was the person that prayed for her? Hallelujah. You go, bro. Go find as many like that and get him healed as you can. If you have diabetes, if you're struggling with diabetes, I prayed for diabetes more than anything else. And one of the first things, I'm not going to call anybody up because I know there's more than one. I'm not going to call anybody up because I know there's more than one. So if you have diabetes, it was the very first thing that God let me get healed when I came back to the United States. I didn't believe that I could heal anybody in North America. But if you have diabetes, just receive this right now in Jesus' mighty name. I command diabetes, go! Diabetes, go now in Jesus' name. You're a thief and a liar. You're a trespasser in the temple. Go now. In Jesus' mighty name, I command every part of the body that's responsible for regulating blood sugar. You work like you're supposed to, and you work now. Blood sugar, you come down into the normal range, and you stay there now. You stay there. You don't go. You stay there now in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. Just receive that. When you get home, check your blood sugar. Any other testimonies? All right, Pastor, I think we're done.
Let me tell you something, amen. How many enjoyed the ministry tonight, the worship? Thank you, Bob, for being here. Thank you for just pouring out your soul and your heart and just everything you are and that you do. And so thankful for him, thankful for you being here. Let me tell you something. Do you know that a lot of Christians, a lot of churches go years and they never see one miracle? And just imagine, just in this short time tonight, all the things we've seen God do. Just in this weekend. Here's the awesome thing. The power, the Bible says, works in you. Exceeding abundantly above all that you could ask or even imagine. God will do more than what you even ask. And That's my prayer for you. That's what I speak over you tonight as you go. God bless you. Have an awesome week. Amen. Tomorrow night, we have our power hour of prayer from 6 to 7. If you want to just guess what we're going to be doing at the prayer meeting, we're going to pray for the sick. We're going to pray for miracles. Amen? We do that, and we do that every Monday night. So if you know somebody that didn't make it tonight, bring them tomorrow night between 6 and 7. We pray corporately, and we're going to be ministering personally as well. So God bless you. Have an awesome week, and be blessed in Jesus' name.
May what I behold still my anxious heart.